Hello everyone and welcome to another podcast episode on MND Fantasy Corner. I'm Duncan and with me is Momo.
Hello everybody, as you can probably hear, there is something new in our intro.
Yes, we are no longer, you know, not professionals. We have a song.
We are moving slowly but surely to professionalism.
Yes.
Now we just need to, you know, make our content be more professional. Music is done. I mean, I was even ashamed to ask him to do this, but he offered it himself. And, you know, when he sent me this music, I was blown away. This is exactly what I was expecting from
him. It sounds so fantasy to me. It's like screaming fantasy.
Yes, anyway, I asked this guy he apparently is not on social media, but if you want, you can, I think, find him. What was his name?
Well, his handle is I Am Electric Man Studios, but you can reach him at iamelectricman20@gmail.com. But you know, all this information will be in description below. So if you guys need some music or anything, hit this guy up. He's really good.
Yes, and also he is on Malazan Reddit. His handle is, I think, Karsa2020, right?
Yes, you can also find him there if you want.
Anyway, man, we really appreciate it, and this is, you know, great. This is everything that we have been hoping for from our intro.
Really, thank you, man, so much.
But there were some other, you know, things that we wanna mention from community.
Something very important.
This was bound to happen sooner or later, guys.
Of course.
But apparently, we've been mispronouncing some names very badly. And, you know,
one of them is Krupe.
Apparently, he's not Krupe, man.
Apparently, he's Krupp. But I was searching about this in some other Reddit thread. And apparently, a lot of people, big majority of people, pronouncing him Krupp. So, E is kind of swallowed in his name. But then some people said that they are pronouncing him Krupe. Some people, actually this was Hurinfan. Username Rezria said even different pronunciation, Krupi. So that's something that we heard first time. We really don't know. We don't know how his name is pronounced.
You know our stumbling here is due in part, I think, because we don't use audiobook. And
maybe.
I think people who use audiobook will probably they will not have this problem.
Yeah, but also there is language barrier because, you know, we are clearly not English-speaking people, so, you know.
Yeah, we will try to pronounce it Krupp, but I can already sense myself that I will fail.
You can guys definitely, yes, you can guys leave us in the comments below if you're saying it, if you're pronouncing his name Krupp or Kruppe or, you know, even something else. And because of this, we were actually thinking about few other race names that we probably mispronounce as well. So I think Tista Andi, Tista Edur, and Tlanimas. So we will just...
I read somewhere that some people actually pronouncing it like Tista Andi.
Yes, but there is another version also. There is Tist Andi or there is Tist Andi. Do you hear the difference?
Tist Andi sound like, you know, some dude from, I don't know, New York.
I know, man, exactly. It's, you know, Andy name is cool, but is it really a name for such an elder and mysterious race?
No.
But you know what? Maybe that's how people pronouncing it. So, guys,
man,
please, leave us in the comments.
Come on. This would make, for example, Anomanda Rake, he would be Tiste Andy. Come on.
I know, man, but you... Who knows? Let people tell us, because, you know, I really want to pronounce it, you know,
I refuse to pronounce it this dandy. It's not this dandy. I'm putting my foot down. Come on, man.
What if it's not even Andy or Andy? Maybe there's something third completely
but
that we don't
it is,
know.
I just don't want to pronounce it Andy.
Okay, but...
I will not.
Just let two more...
I refuse. I don't want to speak about this. I don't want to hear about this.
Okay, what we forget about Andy, but what about Tiste Edur or Tist Idur?
Tist Idur have it sound right to me, although I was pronouncing it Tist Edur, but Tist Idur sound right.
Okay, and the final one that I want to discuss in this episode is Tlan Imas, Ortlan Aymaz.
No, you covered. You skipped one tist.
You skipped the third part.
The third list that is hardest. Yes, they are for me hardest to pronounce.
Come on, man.
I always try to avoid pronouncing their name.
No, so Talan Aymaz or Talan Imaz. This is the, or maybe, you know, it's even different. But guys, please, you know, leave us in the comment because we don't want to mispronounce it.
Both make sense to me, but you know, I'm pronouncing it Talan Aymaz.
Yeah, to me also that sound kind of more mysterious.
But you know, just you know, keep an open mind when we make mistake like this.
Yes, please tell us. That's why I want to say thank you to Chuoki, Hurinfan and Rezria, all of you, you know, for contributing to this. Because, you know, if you guys don't mention this, we will just keep making these mistakes.
Yes, and we have problem not only language barrier, but like I said, neither me or neither Duncan, we don't listen to audiobooks. So we miss that part of pronunciation.
Yes. But I think we can move to chapter 7. That's where we stopped.
We are inching closer to half of the book.
And this chapter starts with something that's very, you know, interesting to me. I love these kind of like secrets.
There was so much information sprinkled here, man. Yes. It's incredible.
This is second Krupp's dream that we are gonna, you know, kind of deconstruct here. There is a lot of information, but we need to tread carefully.
This dream have an unexpected visitor. And there are so many potential spoilers here that we really need to, you know, take care how we approach this subject.
But you can get a lot of information from this. And I think the first, one of the most important information of Malazan world, you can kind of guess what it is when he mentioned that Krull is spawned when somebody spilled blood on his temple in Darujhistan.
Yes, but also I think this is first mention of elder gods also.
I'm not sure if it's first, but you know, I think this is the first time that we are dealing with elder god.
Yes, but you know, it was funny to me how he was calling those other gods children gods.
Yes.
And you know, thing is, we get glimpse here, like Duncan already mentioned, that these gods depend on human worshippers, or in cruel case, apparently sacrifice. I think he mentioned blood and bones.
Exactly.
The moment when in that last chapter, when that assassin was killed in cruel belfry, that, I don't know, kind of revived him.
Yes, so that is kind of this hint that we were saying. But after that...
It's funny to me how, you know, something so random revived basically Elder God. Because this wasn't planned as sacrifice. It just happened there, where, you know, there was his shrine in past.
Well, I don't think that's actually random.
I don't know. It's possible, but it seemed random.
Well, we can kind of... Actually, I want to speak about that now. We can kind of guess who summoned him. Actually, Krull say that who summoned him. He basically say that children gods summoned him. And, you know, if you add two and two together, who orchestrated that event where Talo Krafar died on this, you know, Krull's temple?
Oh! Upon!
Of course. And, you know, children god, that's also a good hint.
Yes.
But there's something that actually Krull made mistake. He said that children god summoned him to defeat some ancient foe. I don't think they summoned him to defeat ancient foe. I mean, I don't want to reveal why did they summon him, but I just want to say that that's the part that I feel that is not true.
To be honest, I'm not sure about that.
You know, I can tell you later.
But either way,
Krull,
you know, admit that he cannot actually win that battle.
Well, he thinks that.
Yes, but he also say, you know, I will lose, but I will not die. Because little bit later here, he say something to Kruppe that Kruppe find interesting. And trust me, guys, if Kruppe finds something interesting and useful information, you should do so too.
Yes. So I want to just say there is another hint here. He say that every god falls at the mortal hands. But this, you know, there is deep meaning. And Kruppe said that he can use it. So, without really spoiling too much what this sentence means, I will just kind of nudge you in the right direction how to think about,
no,
you know, what
me,
you just
to
said.
To me, it sounds pretty straightforward when we couple it with his, you know, resurrection, how he got resurrected. It basically means that if there are no human worshippers, that gods die.
Yes, but how can Kruppe use this information? That is what I wanna, you know, make
to
people
be honest,
think.
I never thought about it.
Well, let's imagine if every god dies at human hand. Can we do reverse?
Oh.
Let's, you know, that's something to think.
Oh, actually, yeah, I get it. It does make sense.
But I don't want
to
say anything more.
You said enough, I think.
Okay, but still. I think, you know, people could, you know, add two and two together.
Man, I missed that completely. Finally, you were useful for something. Finally.
Okay.
I knew that I wasn't your friend for nothing.
Apparently, I'm appreciated well enough.
Okay, so what's next part?
Well, next part, we are cracking another mystery, which is maybe as grand as Elder God himself. We are
that
cracking
is.
Mysteries of Darujhistan and lords and ladies.
Ah, that part.
Yes, apparently I'm joking. It's not that important. But still, it's interesting. There is a subplot going on in this book in Darujhistan that is being done by Murillo and Raliknom.
Yes, Murillo is apparently ladies' man.
Yeah, he's actually, I think they Erikson wrote his dandy fop, which is, you know, such a funny word to me. Maybe to English people, you know, English-speaking people, that word is, you know, normal, but to me it sounds very funny.
Yes, but, you know, I will just say that in case of Murillo, looks can be deceiving, because he is tough guy, I think.
Yes, yes.
He's more than capable of handling himself in fight.
But you know what I'm interested, man? When you read Gardens of the Moon first time, did you crack this mystery in this chapter? Because, you know, now when we reread, it's clear to us, you know, it's so easily to crack this lady mystery. Lady Simta mystery, if you wanna call it.
You know,
it.
Thing is, not only that I didn't crack it, but I didn't even try, because there were so many other things that were confusing me that this seemed like insignificant thing.
Probably most of people felt the same way. But, you know, I don't know if you want to speak about it or shall I just...
You spoil to them. Literally.
Well, it's not really a spoiler because you can understand it. Basically, this lady Simtal, she wanted to kill somebody who is drunk. And she broke his heart, she took his estate, so he was some noble guy. And in last chapter, you guys know who wanted to take and started to take revenge on Lady Simtal. It's Raliknom.
And
we
that
know
guy
who...
has drunk friend.
The drunk friend named Cole. So we kind of already in this chapter know, you know, this little subplot, what's it about. It's basically Lady Simtal wants to kill Cole because she, you know, conned him from all his possessions. And that's pretty much it. But what's
and
interesting
also,
about
also
this...
Also, very important thing to notice is that she's banging Turbano.
She's, you know, she's basically sleeping with all these, you know, councilmen.
She's a busy little bee.
Yes.
But
you know,
to be honest, everybody is sleeping with everybody here.
Yeah, pretty much.
While this, you know, while this Turbanor is banging her, Murillo is banging Turbanor wife.
But listen, man, this is what I wanted to say. Maybe this mystery is cracked, but do you know what is interesting about it? We still don't know how they will take revenge.
Oh, man, you know, nobody except Ralik knows that. Because, you know, if you remember, he had planned to simply kill her, but then Oppon interfered. And, you know, even in this chapter, I think Murillo said that he find it hard to believe that somebody like Raliknom came with such a grand plan.
Yes.
And, you know, we already know that he actually didn't.
Yes, we know who actually played part in that as well. We talked about that in the last episode.
Yes.
And, if, you know, basically, Oppon is everywhere. Oppon is kind of a major player in this book.
But also, you know, what I noticed, that guy that Raliknom killed, Councilman Lim, I think, He was deciding vote in that council decision about Malazan treaty. So I don't know if this was also plan of Opon. Probably yes.
Well, you know, this is the thing that I get with Opon. He kind of doesn't have plan. He's more of a winged guy.
Yes.
So, you know, he's just, you know, doing stuff.
But here I also, you know, realize that Turbanor is not the actual moron who believe that, you know, Malazan will settle for some treaty. He doesn't care about treaty. He just wanna secure his position in the new, you know, Darujhistan hierarchy after Malazan conquered them.
He wants to be high fist man.
Yes, and he doesn't give a damn about anybody else but himself.
But you know what? How can he be high fist when you know what Malazans are doing with nobles?
They are not killing every noble.
Yeah, but you know, it's. I don't think it's up to Mr. Orr to decide who will be.
No. Maybe he planned to suck up to them. Or maybe he's wrong and, he, you know, they will kill him.
You know, I never, you know, gave some credit to these guys. They always kind of sounded stupid to me. And especially, for example, I don't know if you noticed, man. They set tiny tent under Moonspawn. Waiting for Anamander Reik.
Yes.
Dude, like you know, that sounds so pathetic to me. But then here we see, to me this scene was so funny. There's, you know, Croc's point of view and he's so scatterbrained. And he's so young, like in one moment he's thinking about this Diarl girl. The next moment he's thinking, okay, maybe I should rob this ore estate. The next moment, you know, he's, you know, looking at his coin. Moment after that, he's thinking, okay, I should go to Krupp now.
You know where I died laughing?
Where?
When he see Kruppe in distance, and Kruppe is, you know, speaking with some guy, and Krokus interrupts them, but, you know, he's like, okay, I see you are busy, I will leave you two alone. And that guy is like begging, please interrupt us. That guy just wanna leave, man. Can you just imagine how Kruppe was trolling him?
Oh man, I don't think he was trolling him. Krupp is just, you know, that type of guy. Not everybody can listen to him. But then another conversation happened, and this one was also amazing. Kruppe speak with Baruch. And I think this is another case where you get annoyed by Krupp.
I mean, even Baruch get annoyed by
him. Yes, but I don't get annoyed by him. To me, it's just, you know, I just enjoy when he's pulling nerves of people. But did you see that in the end he got that vine?
Oh man, he always get what he wants. That is the thing about Kruppe, man. Always. He will always get what he wants.
Yes, but here I want to, you know, make people, you know, think a little bit about something. Because we still don't know who are these assassins who are killing, you know, Darujhistan assassins. So... And this is something that's very interesting. If Empress Lassine has habit to hire, usually, you know, enemy's assassin, who would profit for killing these guys?
Somebody who is opposing Malazan?
Well, you know, that's for readers and you know, for our listeners to think about. But, you know, I'm just trying to nudge them into the right mindset here. Always think, you know, a little bit deeper.
Yes, you know, it's just important to know that Malazan Empire modus operandi, when they are about to conquer some city, that they send, you know, that they hire actually assassins from that city to kill nobles and mages.
Yes.
But here something is different is happening. Somebody is killing assassins.
Yes. So they are doing just opposite of what Malazan is doing.
Yes. And that implied that this is not Malazan killing assassins.
I feel we kind of spoiled, but you know.
No, this, you know, maybe it is, but you can figure that out with little bit of...
Yes, exactly.
You know, just thinking about that.
But here is one other thing that we realize from this conversation. And, you know, people who are a little bit more perceiving would realize this even before. But basically, Alchemist Baruch is the main power of Darujhistan. And he's... agents are Krupp, Kohl, Murillo, and Relic. And they are all, you know, they are all working together. So this is the main power of the Darujhistan. But you know what else I noticed in the end of this, you know, chapter? There is this beautiful shot. you know, like I'm imagining in the movie, Baruk, the main power of Darujhistan, and he's leaning on the windows and he's thinking about Lasin, you know, his, you know, major opponent. And he's, you know, kind of, he can smell her there.
You know what is ruining that picture for me? Those goddamn workers and the dust that they are, you know, raising by their work.
Exactly. Okay.
Okay, moving on.
Oh, but I don't want to move on because I just want to, you know, give a little assignment to people who didn't read, you know, book completely. There is possibility that in this chapter 7, there is hint of who Eel is. So if you are of the mind, you know, and you want to hunt for it, you know, go ahead and have fun. But I just wanted to say there is hint.
This is hard one. This is hard one.
I don't think it's too hard. But, you know, if you are not looking, you are definitely not going to find it.
I think you are, you know, lying to yourself. Because, you know, you read book and you know what's happening. I don't think you would get it if this was your first time.
I didn't get it first time.
Of course you didn't, because you are not
smart. But that's why we are a little bit helping. And they will find anyway soon. So, but you know why am I happy right now?
Oh, back to the good part.
Bridge burners are
finally
back.
Finally, bridge burners.
Whee!
Man, I swear to you, when I was first time reading this book, whenever I was reading about Darujhistan, I was crying. And whenever I would go back to Bridge Burners, I would like laugh and, you know, like eat those pages where they are on.
Well, we are. I think if there is like real army with Bridge Burners, I would join it.
Man, I read a lot of fantasy. There is no military unit in entire fantasy that I would take over Bridge Burners.
None.
And this is not only because I think they are cool. I think they would eat every other regiment for breakfast.
Man, I don't care if they would eat. I just wanna, you know, I wanna be near Fiddler. I wanna be near Whiskey Jack.
Yes. I do, actually, you don't wanna be near Fiddler and okay. Hedge. Trust me. They are sappers. You don't. If I was in army, I would never be near those two motherfuckers. Those two. I swear to you, one rule, and this might be a spoiler. In Malazan universe, there is no sapper who is normal. Every sapper is at least 50% crazy. That is my opinion. That is my feeling that I got.
Oh,
I don't know if you get the same.
Man. You know, in this chapter, actually, they said Fiddler and Hedge are two happy suppers.
Man, they are happy because they got more ammunition, and they are thinking that with that much munition, they can blow up entire castle. And they are like two small kids playing with fireworks. That's how I imagine.
Well, do you know on what that reminded me? When Fiddler and Hedge are happy, you can insert, I don't know if you know that meme, run. You know, run. Okay,
yes,
when you see Fiddler and Hedge happy, run.
I honestly think that Hedge is a little bit crazier one.
I don't know. Probably yes.
But, you know, just keep this in mind that every supper is at least 50% crazy in my book.
Yeah, but I think now I want to speak a little bit about Morant, because so far we were kind of avoiding them because there was not a lot of information. But here...
Man, I thought that they are some, you know, genocidal maniacs. Who, you know, if you guys remember, they enter Pale and they kill a bunch of innocent civilians.
Yes, but exactly, you know, the number is not random at all.
I think people don't understand that, you know, if you look at those maps, you will notice that a place where Morant live is very close to Pale.
Yes, exactly. And they have history.
And Pale was apparently, you know, stronger one.
Yes.
And they kill exactly the same number of people in Pale as Pale killed Morant in that conflict.
You know how Morant say that? In a beautiful, poetic way. Spirit for spirit.
Yes, but yes.
It's just beautiful. But you know why, guys? I want to tell you something about Morant. They didn't change. They changed this war so much in favor of Malazan. Not only because, for example, munition. Their munition is amazing. But not only munition,
man,
they are also
pearls.
Helping them, you know, in logistics. They are moving, you know, army, they are moving, they are scouting. Morant basically, you know, changed this war. Actually, I think they kind of balanced it.
Yes, but they really changed, not only war, but they changed composition of Malazan military. Because before Morant appeared and, you know, introduced their Morant munition, sappers were not really a huge thing, but you know, with introduction of those munitions, sappers became very important.
Yes.
Like military units.
If you wanna run, that's what I wanna say.
Yes.
But you know, I wanna ask you this, man. You remember when, you know, Whiskey Jack said, okay, we are scrapping this plan, it was designed to kill us. What did you do first time when that happened?
Oh man, I was happy.
Man, I jumped and I started fist pumping. Yeah! Show to that Lassine who's the boss. I don't know why, but you know, that it had that effect on me.
Man, but it's such a strange thing for me. For example, you know, like we are maybe near half of the book. And we don't know basically nothing about Whiskey Jack. You agree with me?
Yes.
But you know, like I think 80% of people love him who read the book. But why they love him when they don't know anything about him?
I don't know, man. Can you tell me? Also, but I want to know. Explain me.
For me, maybe I'm wrong. But, you know, you are... When you see this guy interacting with other characters from the book, you see that everybody is respecting this guy. And you cannot help, you know, but to start respecting him yourself. You think, even though you don't know nothing about him, even though he didn't deserve it, he didn't do nothing to deserve that respect from you. You are thinking, if all these guys are respecting him and bridge burners, then that must, you know, mean that these bridge burners are, you know, deserving that respect.
I don't know, maybe because, you know, we kind of get point of view of several characters in this first book, and I think he's... is the most, not noble, but most human. Maybe that's why.
Yes, but he's also noble, man.
Yes, but for example, he doesn't mind killing. Or for example, when you talk to him about that bridge burners, you know, his answer is, you know, he just shrugs you. He say, you know, they are good at dying. But you know, you can see that's just cover. It hurts him.
I remember, I really remember that part when Tattersall said to him, you know, those were good soldiers, those bridge burners, and he said, yeah, good at dying. It seemed so cold, but I felt tightness in my chest, like I wanna cry, because I knew right away that he's pretending.
Of course, man. I don't know, I feel the same way about Whiskey Jack like you. Like, I don't know what's about him, but he's like father, I don't know.
Yes, and I really think that he would, like, sacrifice himself for each and every one of his soldiers. And they would do the same for him.
Yes. But I think we can finish this chapter with a very interesting conversation. I think this one is my favorite one. This conversation is so complex that... and so full of kind of some spoilers. I don't even know how to talk about it, man.
Let's start from the beginning. First of all, we see that Herlock is madder than ever.
Basically, he's completely mad. He lost it.
Man, you know where I was?
Where?
When he pulled the knife on Quick Ben. Can you imagine that, you know, situation? Quick Ben is fairly tall.
Yes.
And there is some puppet, like maybe, I don't know, he's maybe 10, 20 centimeters tall. And he's pulling some small knife and stalking, you know, towards Quick Ben, like threateningly. Can you imagine that scene? In my head, it's such a funny scene.
You know what I'm imagining? How big that knife is? What if that knife is as big as Herlock? Because that's a possibility.
Oh man, it's small knife because he pulled it out of his belt. It cannot be big.
So
it's a man's small knife.
It's too big.
Yes. But you know what's even, you know, actually this is not funny. This is scary. Scary thing is that Quick Ben is afraid when that happens.
Well, I don't really think he's too afraid, man. I think he's just kind of stunned.
Apprehensive.
He's
yes.
observing, you know, yes. Herlock, you know, became his subject.
But I really don't know how to approach this without, you know, like major spoilers. And I really don't want to spoil
it. I want to say at least part of it first.
Okay, you should.
This is something that you should ask yourself, but it's impossible for you to realize it. But this should be strange to you guys. How does Quick Ben know about Spar of Andi? How he knows so much about Chaos Warren?
Yes, and he even said to, you know, Herlock that he was here before.
That is very, very interesting little sentence. That I cannot believe that Erikson actually knew all of this. So many years
ago. Okay, Here is the thing, guy. Keep this in mind, and in book 10, you will say,
Keep this in mind even after book 10.
Yes, but you know, this dude knew from the book 1 where he wanna go with Quick Ben. Exactly.
It's so crazy, man. I'm fascinated by Erikson.
Yes.
I'm doing this show and I'm becoming more and more fan of him.
Man, to be honest, when I first finished this series, I was impressed by it. But my real appreciation for this series and for Steven Erikson started after rereading it. Because I swear, on reread, you start to get the sense of how awesome and how, you know, how tight this world is.
You know,
you don't get this on first.
Of course you don't get, but to me, when I'm trying to find some irregularities, some mistakes, it's difficult. It's difficult to find, yes, in such a, you know, big universe. It's crazy.
But man, I don't know, did you notice that Quick Ben apparently no face of Gear?
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, as far as we know, he never met him before.
Yes, that's another hint, guys, for you.
Yes, another one for your file cabinet to put in.
Quick Ben is mystery on its own. I think if we made an episode just about Quick Ben, it would last 10 hours.
Probably. I think he is most mysterious guy in this universe.
I still love Callum more. I'm just gonna say that.
Oh, well, I don't, but you know, it's you know, Callum is awesome too. But anyway, I think this is it for these two episodes.
Guys, don't forget to give us your comments and your opinion how to pronounce Krupp, how to pronounce Tistandi, Idur, Edur, Tlanimas. And you know, maybe next episode we will bring up some other names also.
Yes, and you know, you guys maybe, you know, get the sense of that already, but if you didn't, fact is, your comments really help us. It helps us make this, you know, just a little bit better every week, I think.
Exactly.
So, you know, keep them coming, and I hope you will enjoy it. See ya in next episode, guys.